and welcome to this Q&A session on studying master's degree at the University of Reading. We're sorry we can't be with you live, but we have lots of questions that have already been sent in, which we are hoping to answer. Today I'm joined by a panel of experts from the university, and over the next 30 minutes or so, we'll try to answer your questions as we go. My panel includes Chris Cagney. He's a regional officer for Sub-Saharan Africa from the Global Recruitment Team. We also have Anthony Keeble, one of our senior admissions managers. We have Phil Etherington, student recruitment officer for the UK Student Recruitment Outreach Team, and we have Grace Connell with us. And Grace has just completed a Master's in Behavioural Finance here at the University of Reading. So we've had a few questions sent over to us already today, and we're going to kick off by trying to answer some of those. Our first question I'm going to direct to Anthony.
Thank you.
Can IELTS tests be taken on arrival at the university?
They can't, no, if you're a student that needs a visa to come to the UK, because obviously your offer needs to be unconditional for us to be able to issue you with your CAS so you can get your visa to come to the UK. There are test centres available in the UK, but again, if you are a European student who needs to come and do an IELTS test, leaving it that late is probably not the best idea, and it's not going to leave you enough time for the start of term. So we recommend doing your IELTS test well in advance of starting the university.
Thank you very much, Anthony. Another question here I'm going to direct towards Chris. Do international students get an opportunity to secure jobs in the UK due to Brexit?
They do. I'll talk about international students first, if I may, distinguishing between international and EU students. Most international students will be able to work up to 20 hours per week on an international visa. They can work full time during holidays. So there's every opportunity to create an income for essential extras while you're studying. I would say do not, under any circumstances, go beyond that 20 hours a week allowable on your visa. Or you may lose your visa. So there is capacity there, but you must be very, very careful if ever asked to go beyond that by an employer to absolutely not do that under any circumstances. We have what's called campus jobs on campus, and that contains a huge number of opportunities to work with us in our recruitment team, as ambassadors, as members of the university's work, of a huge variety of different types of work on campus, but also employers around Reading and around the university who might be looking for part-time workers, of which students very often are very, very good examples, good employees. They will often, you know, be hardworking, be good communicators, and display a whole set of skills that employers really, really value. And so, yeah, there's lots of opportunity to work as an international student. Now, Brexit is a slightly larger affair to begin to discuss. And I think all we can really reliably say about Brexit at the moment and employment is that there's a lot of uncertainty. The main thing to establish is that international students and EU students are a huge part of the University of Reading, 4,000 international students. And EU students out of 20,000. It's a very, very welcoming place, and I would just say don't allow Brexit and the discussions around it to dissuade you from making Reading your choice, because this is an extremely international, extremely welcoming environment. In terms of work permits and so on, a bit more complex, but I think that would be my message.
Anthony. Is there more opportunities once you've finished your degree to be able to stay on and work following a master's degree?
So the University of Reading is fortunate to be one of the few universities that's a Tier 4 pilot institution. So for international students that need a visa coming on a master's programme, you're given 6 months, that's the end of the visa, so an extended period to be able to find a job, and then once you found a job, you would then need to swap to the relevant work visa, which you would do through the employer that you get that job with. But that extended period is good because it just allows you that bit more time to A, relax after finishing your master's degree, and then B, get looking for that job and have a little bit more time to actually do it.
And many universities in the UK eligible for this scheme?
There's only about 26 universities, if I remember correctly, that are part of the Tier 4 pilot that get that slightly extra extended time.
Great, thank you very much. I'm going to ask a question towards Grace here. What do you think is different about Reading compared to other universities?
I think probably the main thing I've noticed, I did my undergraduate at Reading as well, so I haven't experienced another university, but I think the main thing would be the campus and the feel of the campus and how it's in one place, because I know that at so many universities, things are sort of stretched across a whole city or a whole town. At Reading, what sort of the central campus is, RUSU, the Students' Union, and then all the departments are on campus, and accommodation is also on campus, sort of 5 minutes walk, some of them, from the central campus. So the main thing is sort of the central feel and how easy it is to find a way around and meet different people.
Lovely, that's great. And so what is Reading like as a place to live, the town?
The town is great. I think it's not like a big city. Sort of the train station and sort of the shopping centre and the restaurants are all very centralised, and they're very easy to get through to from the campus as well through a regular bus. So in terms of getting around, it's really easy, and getting sort of to London and other areas of the UK as well, Reading is sort of a really central place to be. And living wise, you've got everything that you could need. And I think probably the fact that it's not too big makes it a really manageable place to live, especially if you're coming kind of far away from home.
Thanks, Grace. Chris has already touched on this a little bit, but I know that you work particularly with current students who work for us as student ambassadors. So do you think you could talk a little bit about what part-time opportunities, job opportunities are for students who are studying here?
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, as Chris mentioned, we've got a fantastic job shop, now called Campus Jobs, as part of the student services on the campus. And that advertises all the different job opportunities on the campus and also some job opportunities in town as well. And that's a really fantastic resource to find part-time and flexible working. So you touched on this as well in terms of not working more than 20 hours as a master's student. So it's really important to be able to have access to flexible jobs. So for example, Grace has been doing lots of work for my team in terms of getting involved with Masters Open Days, kind of writing student profiles, getting involved with this Q&A session, and that's been very flexible around her studies, well, have you found that? I think that's a fantastic resource that we have on campus.
And it includes really good rates of pay, I think, for the students. So the rates of pay are very generous.
Yeah.
But also, the whole system that JobShop has set up doesn't allow students during term time to work more than 20 hours per week through JobShop, so you don't need to worry too much. It won't let you submit longer hours than that anyway, so you wouldn't have to have any worries about any implications for your visa. I'm going to move on a little bit. We've talked a little bit about the IELTS test, but can we talk a bit about pre-sessional English? So what's a pre-sessional English course?
Okay, so the university has our International Study and Language Institute, which offers pre-sessional English programmes as well as academic English support programmes for those that are on a programme of study here already. But the pre-sessional are English language courses of varying lengths, anywhere from about 4 weeks up to a full year if you need it. to allow you to get your English language up to the level that you need for entry onto the programme of study that you've chosen to go on to. The length of course that you need depends on your existing English language ability, so we need to see an IELTS certificate to determine what level you're at and how long the course you need. They're obviously studied in advance of joining the master's programme that you would like to join. And we get some students who actually do them even although they've already got the English language level that they need, because they're a mixture of English language, tuition, as well as contextual study for the subject that you're going into. And a great introduction to life in the UK, actually. So you can see what the university's like, you start to meet other fellow international students. So they're a nice introduction before going on to the master's programme proper.
So if you have the IELTS score that you need to join your programme, do you have to take a pre-sessional programme?
No, you don't have to take one. You can choose to if you want to. And if you haven't got the IELTS score, you don't have to do one either. One advantage of doing the pre-sessional, however, if you don't quite have the right English language level, is a large number of our courses will allow what we call a half-band credit. So actually the score that you get at the end of your pre-sessional is allowed to be slightly lower than the normal IELTS score that you would need to gain entry onto the programme.
Thanks, Anthony. I'm going to come back to Grace now and ask about what activities, societies or sports are there for Master's students to get involved with on campus?
Good question. I think it's very similar. The societies are all the same, undergrad and postgrad, so everyone can get involved in the same things. And I think it's currently 150 societies and sport clubs, so massive range. Sort of, I think there's all the ones to do with your subject, and there's an international society which I've been involved in because lots of my friends have been part of that, and then all the sports ones, really every sport you can think of. So masses, basically, is the answer to that. Sort of, there's so many to choose from. That's probably
fantastic.
It's probably worth noting as well that we, although it's 150, many of them are sports, a huge number of sports. Mm. And even though we currently don't have a pool on campus at the University of Reading, we do have a very, very active swimming society, which is a great way to meet fellow swimmers, extremely sociable, and a really, really good example of one of the many societies. So, you know, the fact we don't actually have a pool on campus is in no way prevented us from creating students creating a society. And if there's a society which you would like to see, a sport which isn't represented, then students are able to found their own societies in partnership groups with the Students Union.
Yes, so international students have made a huge impact in this area, creating things like the University of Reading's Model United Nations, as well as the Trading and Investment Society, and all of these were actually originally set up by international students. If you can find enough people who want to do a certain activity that you want to do, then you can found a society and you can get that off the ground working with the Students' Union. So do take up all of those opportunities available to you. I'm going to potentially come towards Phil with this question, but Chris might also be able to help with this. What sort of accommodation is there for families at the university?
For families, it is quite limited, to be completely honest. We have about 30 rooms for families in our accommodation at the university, but it is very, very popular. So often we find that families do end up living in private accommodation, of which there is a lot around the campus in Reading. And also our Students' Union provide help with finding private accommodation, so a lot of people use that service to find that. So those are kind of the availability.
Absolutely. So the Students' Union will provide help with things like checking contracts, making sure that everything that you're doing in preparation to renting your property is all done the right way, and they'll give you advice on landlords and where to find the right sort of housing. So there's plenty of advice and support available if you decide that living in university accommodation isn't an option and that you might want to live off campus but close by. And there's usually more housing around the university than there are students to take it up.
There is, and what I can say from personal experience as well as the students that I've worked with, that Reading Whitemans campus is very, very fortunate, actually, and London Road is very fortunate in having a really, really first class stock of housing. It's a very, very desirable area around the university, and so there's a high number of, the standard thing is kind of beautiful Victorian houses in kind of quiet, leafy streets. And so if you can't get on campus, there's a very, very good chance that one of our local estate agents or our approved landlords will have property which they, year in, year out, rent out to families, postgrads and so on. They know their market, they know the students they want to engage with, they understand their needs. And so there's, in, you know, I, would express the opinion there's not a huge dividing line between the on-campus experience and the off-campus renting experience. There's a building I'm familiar with which is virtually on campus, it's on London Road, it's full of PhD students, one alumni who's at the Royal Horticultural Society, and the students who are in there are having a very, very good time. You can buy you can rent two or three bedroom houses in the immediate area as well. So there's a huge amount of choice. One thing I would say, and I think this is fairly standard advice, but I'm going to say it anyway, is to, if you absolutely possibly can, to get to see the accommodation before you accept it. I think that's very important as a general piece of advice. Yes, everything's in place to help you through the union to get a really good private rent if you need it. But I can't overestimate the importance of just, if you don't go, you don't know, basically, and just being in the place and seeing if you like, if it's right for you is very, very advisable indeed.
On the kind of accommodation theme, it might be worth adding, for accommodation on campus, there are postgraduate areas, so when you apply for accommodation on campus, if you make it clear that you're a postgraduate student, they'll make sure they put postgraduates together, and that creates a really good community in the halls of residence with kind of like-minded people.
If you have a look at your emails, and you also might have a look at the Meet at Reading applicant portal, you'll find that there's an awful lot of information. So we'll have sent you emails talking about what your accommodation options are and what your choices are, and depending on whether or not you've accepted your offer, you'll be invited to apply for accommodation through the university systems. Or you'll also be able to look on your Meet Reading applicant portal to find articles and guidance on finding university accommodation, but also looking at the private accommodation that's available. So do check that out. So I'm going to move on to Welcome Week now. What happens during Welcome Week, and is there anything that students and applicants need to do before they arrive? I'll start with Anthony as the pre-arrival area.
Okay, thank you. You've had your offer, you've accepted your offer, which is great. Let's assume it was conditional and you've now met all of the offer conditions. So you've sent us all the documentation that we need. And if you haven't sent us the documentation, that's really important to do so. We need your results or whatever's missing so that we can make your place unconditional. We will then send you instructions for online enrolment, and that will include links to the university's website, which will show the whole range of activities, the timetable, the different areas of the university that are participating in Welcome Week, as well as giving you that link to online enrolment. We would encourage you to do online enrolment before you get here if you can. You could do it, as it says, online. It's basically going through, confirming all the details that we hold about correct, filling in any gaps, so any missing information about you. And also as part of that, you can pay your tuition fees as well. And you can pay all of your fees if you want to. To fully enrol, you need to pay at least half your tuition fee if you're not being sponsored. So you can do that as part of the online enrolment process as well. And then when you arrive at the university, you can take part in all the activities there, get your campus card, etc. Chris may want to chip in with the activities once you're here.
I think the things to think about, I'm going to emphasise and echo the points that you make there, which is certainly make sure that you have met all of your conditions and you have that message that says you are now unconditional, because that's extremely important. After online enrolment, when you arrive, let's look at a couple of the dates. Obviously, it's online, you don't need to scribble this down right now, and you will be given these as well, but you can pick up your BRP, which is your biometric residence permit, on the 17th of September. It's also open during the weekend on the 22nd and the 23rd. Register your immigration documents between the 20th to the 26th. This is with an international focus of September. You will need to register with the police. You need to register with your GP. There's a fee for both of those, including your access to NHS. So there's some really quite important pieces of administration to get through once you arrive. But I think the key thing, once you, you know, once you've got those ticked off your to-do list, the key thing to do in that first week is to get a feel for the University of Reading campus, to make friends, to participate in Welcome Week and join the society, have a good round, drink lots of coffee or hot chocolate if you prefer. Just really get a feel for what this place is about. There are tours available, and I think, you know, it's extremely important to begin as you mean to carry on. And so it's a process of orientation, of joining societies, making friends. At Heathrow, and sorry for the international focus on this, I know we've got UK students as well, but if you're coming into Heathrow, we will send a welcome party for you, which usually consists of staff and students in bright University of Reading t-shirts. We're not there alone. Several other universities who are expecting their students to come in through Heathrow will also be there. So it's a bit of a kind of university festivity day on Heathrow during Welcome Week. Make sure you let us know that you're coming, get booked in. And we won't drive you to campus, but we will direct you to where you need to go to get to campus.
And that runs for 3 days over the first Welcome Weekend. So yes, Friday, the Saturday and the Sunday before Welcome Week officially begins is when there'll be a meet and greet team at Heathrow to help you get on the right bus and get yourselves to Reading.
Sorry, just worth adding as well that during Welcome Week there are specific postgraduate activities, so both social events and kind of talks on settling in, being a master's student at Reading. And also the Welcome Week team send out emails about this programme, what's happening June and July, so do keep an eye on your emails if you're starting this year. Those should be coming in pretty soon.
And one of the things to add is that this year there's going to be an app available with all of the activities that you need to be involved in. And as you sign up for activities, the app will guide you to where you're supposed to be and when, and there'll be regular updates on the app that will help guide you through the Welcome Week process, so you will always know where you need to be and what you need to be doing and which activities you should be getting involved in. I think that's all the time that we have today, but do by all means send in questions, send them through the Facebook page to us or reply to the email that you've been sent. And we will try and answer more of your questions in more detail if you have any other things that you'd like to know. But can I thank the panel for joining me today?
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us as well. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.